chair the session in the afternoon.
Yeah, so I propose to talk about changing concepts of light and matter, the most basic ideas in physics. And just as space and time, these are ideas that are probably hardwired into our brain. We have a very strong intuitive understanding what they are. And this understanding helps us in surviving, but it hinders progress in understanding. So light is what we perceive our world with, and it has been, so I cannot advance my slides. Oh yeah. light has been the subject of religion, philosophy. Only in the last few centuries have people begun to think about the nature of light. Artists like Leonardo da Vinci observed that if you arrange the different colors of light in a circle, like here, that you get the most pleasing effects if you combine opposite colors. But the question, what really is light, was asked for the first time in a systematic way by Newton, who observed that if you send white light, a sun ray, through a glass prism, it disperses this white light into a rainbow of colors. And Newton felt that different colors must correspond to different kinds of light particles. Then in the 19th century, Thomas Young observed interference fringes with light. He observed that light can behave like water waves. If you send light through a double slit, you observe a pattern of fringes, and he argued, like water waves, if the waves oscillate in phase, they interfere constructively, they make it bright. If they oscillate out of phase, they can cancel each other through destructive interference. This wave theory was put by Fresnel into mathematical form, and this Fresnel theory is still enormously useful to understand many diffraction and interference phenomena in optics. From experiments of this kind, Young was able to derive the wavelengths of visible light. If we know the wavelengths, we can calculate the frequency. We take the speed of light and divide by the frequency, so we come to the conclusion that if something oscillates, it oscillates at a million billion times per second for visible light. And of course, today we know that this is just a small part of the spectrum of electromagnetic waves that range from radio waves to gamma rays. The effect of light interference was exploited by Michelson in the late 19th century to see if there is a detectable effect on the speed of light from the motion of the Earth. So he set up his Michelson interferometer and rotated it in the laboratory, and he came to the conclusion that the speed of light is always the same. It does not change. And this was, of course, what inspired Einstein and others to change our concepts of time and space. But this is not the subject of my presentation here today. I just want to mention that even after Einstein, people continued to speculate that time and space might be something different altogether, some emergent phenomena that would not exist outside a universe. So this is the wave nature of light, but then already in the late 19th century, Max Planck wondered how this wave picture is compatible with the observed spectrum of radiation that comes from hot bodies, black body radiation. And he felt that that cannot be explained unless one makes a very radical assumption that the energy of light is quantized, that there are energy quanta given by Planck's constant times the frequency of light. With it, one could perfectly match the observed intensity distribution of light. So these light quanta or photons can be brought out by properly designed experiments. So dependent on what you do in your experiment, light can behave as if it was a wave or as if it was made of particles. And here is an example, an interference pattern building up from individual of these particles. Clauser and Aspe were probably the first to show experimentally that these particles show a very strange counterintuitive phenomenon called entanglement that's predicted by quantum theory. And nowadays there are quantum engineers who use this aspect of light to devise quantum cryptography, quantum information processing, quantum computing. The wave nature of light was put on a new basis with the invention of the laser. Art Scholow and Charlie Townes, in a seminal paper, proposed that one could make amplifiers and oscillators for light waves just as for radio waves. The first laser was realized in 1960, the first Ruby laser. And this has led to an avalanche of laser-related work and research with lasers that, if you include the most recent chemistry Nobel Prize on super-resolution microscopy, now counts 26 Nobel laureates whose work has been based on this laser. So much for light. What about matter? Well, of course, we all know that the ancient philosophers speculated that there might be some smallest indivisible building blocks of matter. These thoughts were largely forgotten till in the 19th century, chemists, including John Dalton, put it on a more quantitative basis. Dalton observed that if you look at chemical reactions, in what quantity, in what proportions different elements combine to form new molecules, that really substantiate that picture that each element is made up of smallest building blocks, and one could now quantitatively find out what are the relative weights of these atoms, but nobody had any idea how these atoms behave. It was known that they must be complex. Fraunhofer was the first to observe spectral lines, sharp spectral lines, in the light emitted by the sun, and then came spectral analysis by Kirchhoff, Bunsen, and others that showed that different elements have characteristic spectra, like fingerprints, and this could only be explained if they have some complicated inner structure, maybe like pianos or so. The simplest of the atoms, the lightest, the hydrogen atom, has a particularly regular spectrum, and Balmer, a Swiss schoolteacher, came up with an empirical formula for the wavelength of these Balmer lines, later generalized by Rydberg. And so in this context, they introduced the empirical Rydberg constant, but nobody had any idea why that was so, and how big the Rydberg constant should be. Further progress became possible only when radioactivity was discovered by Becquerel, and when Rutherford observed that by scattering alpha rays from thin gold foils, that the mass and positive charge of an atom must be in a very small central nucleus. Previously, people had thought that maybe light electrons and positive charges are like raisins in a pudding or so. But after Rutherford's discovery, we knew that there is a small, heavy, positively charged nucleus in the atom, and light electrons must be going around. So then Niels Bohr wondered if, with this understanding, one could explain the Balmer spectrum of hydrogen. And so he looked at a planetary model where a single electron would go around the nucleus, a proton, and he came to the conclusion that, like Planck, one has to make a revolutionary assumption to get agreement with the observations. He assumed that not just any planetary orbit is possible, but only discrete quantized orbits where the angular momentum is a multiple of Planck's constant, and that radiation is emitted or absorbed in transitions between these stationary orbits. And so with this assumption, he could actually give an expression. He could express the Rydberg constant in terms of the electron mass, the electron charge, Planck's constant, and the speed of light. So that was a sensational result, but it had many shortcomings, and but it inspired other people to come up with deeper insights. And one very deep insight was that electrons can behave like waves. Light can behave like particles, but matter can behave like waves. And if we assume these matter waves, then we can ask what should be the wavelength to give a resonance. An integer number of wavelengths would have to fit into the orbit. And so with this, one would arrive at discrete orbits. And Erwin Schrödinger then came up with a mathematical wave equation for these matter waves that can be solved in closed form for the hydrogen atom, and that tells us the shape of the actual orbit. One question that is discussed today intensely, as it was at the time of Schrödinger, is what does this equation actually describe? And one very pragmatic explanation is that what it describes is our information about the probability of clicks and meter readings. This is essentially the Copenhagen interpretation made more consistent and more pointed by this approach of cubism by Christopher Fuchs, Merman, and Schack. And to my mind, I think that's the only reasonable way of understanding what this describes. So the rules of quantum mechanics are very general, and they can be applied without knowing the underlying reality, similar to the rules of thermodynamics. But of course, that is not satisfying. We like to have a deeper understanding. But at the present point, this deeper understanding has to come from philosophy, from interpretation, not from physics. But to continue, Dirac showed that one can generalize the Schrödinger equation to include the ideas of Einstein, of relativity. And so with his Dirac equation, he miraculously could describe the spin of the electron that had been observed in spectra, and also the existence of anti-electrons, of positrons. And so his equation was so beautiful that people felt this must be the ultimate explanation of this microscopic world, till after the Second World War, Willis Lamb showed in certain terms that Dirac was not right, that two levels of the hydrogen atom that should have precisely the same energy according to Dirac, the so-called 2s and 2p state, that they actually are split, they are degenerate. And this splitting was then explained in intuitive terms by Bethe as the effect of vacuum fluctuations of the electromagnetic field that are always present even at absolute zero temperature, and by vacuum polarization, the fact that vacuum can behave like a dielectric because you can create out of nothing virtual electron positron pairs. This was the beginning of the development of quantum electrodynamics. For this development, Tomonaga, Schwinger, and Feynman received the Nobel Prize in 65. And this, in many minds, has concluded this chapter. Now we understand perfectly matter and its interactions with electromagnetic radiation. We are now at a point where maybe we discover that this is not so. But let me just continue. So, of course, the high energy physicists had discovered all kinds of strange resonances that finally could be explained by the standard model. Murray Gell-Mann received the Nobel Prize in 69 for his contributions and discoveries concerning the classification of elementary particles and their interactions. For atomic physicists, what is maybe most relevant is that the nucleus, even of the simple hydrogen atom, is not an elementary particle, but it's a composite system made up of quarks and gluons. And so one can ask, how big is it? What is the size of this proton? And this is where maybe we have arrived at a contradiction, where one can question whether quantum electrodynamics is already providing the ultimate answers. In our own work, for decades, we have used lasers and laser spectroscopy to look at the spectrum of the hydrogen atom with ever higher resolution and ever higher precision. It started in the early 70s at Stanford University, where we, for the first time, were able to resolve individual fine structure components of the red Balmer alpha line. And this quest has continued over decades. Here is a graph that documents how the fractional frequency uncertainty has improved over time. So now a certain narrow hydrogen transition we can measure with 15 digits of precision. It's the 1s, 2s resonance. And the tool for doing that is the frequency comb that was acknowledged when the Nobel Prize of 2005 was awarded to Jen Hall and myself. From such measurements and comparisons of different transitions in hydrogen and from quantum electrodynamic theory, one can derive the size of the proton. There is a better way to measure the size of the proton, and that is to look not at ordinary hydrogen, but at muonic hydrogen, where the electron is replaced by its much heavier brother, also a lepton, the muon, 200 times heavier, that comes 200 times closer to the proton. There, here is also a lamp shift that you can observe this time by laser spectroscopy and an international collaboration that has done such measurements has come to the conclusion that the proton size measured in the muonic atom is smaller by about 4% than the size measured in the ordinary hydrogen atoms or measured by electron scattering experiments at large accelerators. This has been confirmed more recently, so the puzzle is not solved. And maybe it's due to a mistake, but it could also be a hint that we don't completely understand physics at this level yet. There are other experiments in preparation. Maybe even next year we should see first spectroscopic studies of antihydrogen at CERN, and to see if antimatter and matter behave precisely the same as they should according to our present understanding, or if there are differences. The same tools that allow these precise measurements are now being adopted by astronomers to ask some questions. One can search for Earth-like planets, but one can also invent new tests for general relativity, one can ask the question, are fundamental constants really constant, or are they slowly changing with time? Are cosmic redshifts changing with time? Can we get evidence for the continuing expansion of the universe? And of course, cosmologists remind us that 95% of the universe consists of unknown constituents. We don't know what is dark matter. We don't know what is dark energy. So there is plenty of room for discoveries. And I like the method of the little chicken that is not fixated on a particular goal, but wanders around out of curiosity and might discover that the fence is not closed in the back and that one can reach the goal much more easily. So this is the end of the presentation.